Welcome to the planning committee. My name is Councillor Lisa Leach and I'm the chair of the committee. My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people on the table here tonight are, to my immediate right is the council solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on any procedural or legal matters that may arise. To my left are the council's planning officers, highway engineer and environmental health officer, who will present the applications this evening and give any technical advice to the committee which may be sought. The rest of the people you will see down both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualifying petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition and speak for up to 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the resident if required. However, once the ward councillors return to the public galleries, they may not return to take part in any debate that may be followed by the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. The order of tonight's agenda may vary subject to the numbers of people who are here for a particular item on the agenda, and subject to the committee agreeing to the order being varied. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee, then that matter will not be discussed this evening and will be discussed at a subsequent meeting following the committee visiting the site. If anybody is here for any of those applications, they may leave at that point if they so wish. Committee can have approval of the minutes on pages 1 to 18. Thank you. Do any members have declarations of interest?
If we discuss any appeal decisions, there's an appeal decision there involving the gentleman, which I report that way.
Okay, do we have any requests for site visits? David?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I've got three requests for site visits, two for my own purposes and one on behalf of Paul Cage, who, as you know, is unable to attend the meeting. So the requests for site visits are as follows. Item 4, which is South Parade, West Kirby. The first one is for item 4, South Parade, West Kirby. I think due to the nature and character of what is being proposed, it's absolutely essential that the committee looks at the development in context of site. The next one is item 9, which I'm asking for on behalf of Councillor Hayes, Green Lane and Wallasey, again because of its impact, serious potential impact advocacy by residents on the adjoining properties. And finally, on item 10, which is Springfield 34 Gorse Lane. And the reasons for that request are really related to perceived substantial changes of unique character in this established area, serious exacerbation of existing vehicular access problems and loss of general amenity value. So I move those three, please, Chairman, as being more suitable for site visit. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. If I could ask for a site visit on number 12, which is Riverside House East Street, Seacombe, due to the public interest in the proximity to residential properties, I feel the committee would benefit from a site visit.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Item 8, which is 17 apartments in Highfield, South Rock Ferry, I'm on court site visit on that one, please, for overdevelopment.
Okay, I've got a room for site visits from members.
Yes,
thank you. So So for the general public that are here this evening, agenda item 4, South Parade, West Kirby, we will not be discussing this evening. Agenda item 8, 143, Highfield Road off Ferry, we will not be discussing this evening. 8, Green Lane, Wallasey, we will not be discussing this evening. 34 Gores Lane, Newton, we will not be discussing this evening. And Riverside House, East Street, will not be discussed this evening. So if anybody would like to leave now, then please feel free to do so. We'll give you a couple of minutes. Thank you.
Yes, you're
I'll be back. I'm just going to say hello to my friend.
Jerry.
Jerry. Yeah.
Jerry. We're going to look at the agenda item 13 next. So if you want to sort of buy it yourself or anything else on. It's on pages 97 to 104.
Planning Commission has sought the erection of three detached dwellings with integral garages on four of the nursery gardens in Heswall. The site is located within the primarily residential area and also Lower Heswall Village conservation area. Development is permitted on allotment gardens that have become surplus to requirements. This site is not identified for protection in the Unitary Development Plan, and its potential for publicly accessible open space has been taken into account. Public open space within Heswall already exceeds the standard 2.4 hectares per 1,000 population, and as such, the site is accepted as being surplus to requirements. The site immediately to the south-southwest of the site, adjacent to St. Peter's Primary School, has recently been granted permission for four houses with access via Thurston Road. The applicants and agents are the same on this application, although the developments are not linked and are physically separated by West Grove. Access to this development would be via DEE VIEW ROAD, utilising the existing access whilst making improvements which will allow for a satisfactory and safe means of access. Off-street parking with the provision of integral garages and driveways is proposed for each dwelling. The layout, scale and use of materials for each dwelling reflects those of neighbouring properties and also reflects the scale and design of the recently approved scheme opposite of West Grove. The design, scale and form of development, together with the choice of materials proposed, are considered to reflect the character of the wider area as a whole. Although the site is located within the conservation area, this should not prohibit the new development altogether. Rather, care should be had to the setting of the conservation area, ensuring the proposals do not detract from the special features of that area. The design elements employed on the proposals mirror distinctive features within the conservation area, and the careful use of quality materials, the modest scale of the development, and no loss of trees or hedgerows will ensure the character of the conservation area will not be harmed. Care has also been taken to ensure that the council's usual separation distances have been achieved, in order to ensure that overlooking and loss of privacy does not result from for neighbouring properties. The proposals represent a choice of quality homes, and the design of each dwelling is considered acceptable. The proposals do not harm the amenities of neighbouring properties and are considered to be in keeping with the character of the area. The development is recommended for approval, and there is a qualified petitioner of objection. There are also additional conditions set out on the late list I just found out to see the layout to show on the screen, and I can show the screen scene if I just want to as well.
We do have a qualifying petition for this application. Would the petitioner like to come forward to speak on this matter? You have a microphone in front of you there, just put it towards your mouth, and there's a silver button if you can just press that. And as I said earlier, you have to have to speak. You can just state your name.
Thank you, councillors. My name is Stuart Barton. I'm a chartered town planner. I'm also a former planning inspector, and I've had experience determining several, well, dozens actually, of conservation area cases. So my experience speaks for itself, really. The issue of the allotment gardens is really a bit of a red herring, because the principal legal test relates to the conservation area. The officer has misdirected herself and the committee. She states in the committee report that the fact that the site is within a conservation area is not a reason to restrict development. Rather, to ensure that the land is used in a sustainable way, taking account of its setting within a conservation area. That's the wrong test. Paragraph 14 of the National Planning Policy Framework, including footnote 9, which establishes the presumption in favour of sustainable development, states that otherwise acceptable proposals should be granted permission unless specific policies in this framework indicate development should be restricted. And footnote 9 includes designated heritage assets, which includes conservation areas, in the list of sites where development should be restricted. So the officer is dead wrong. Conservation areas are designated heritage assets and development must be restricted, but how? The correct legal test is set out in section 72.1 of the Planning List of Buildings and Conservation Areas Act 1990, to wit, would a proposal preserve or enhance the character or appearance of the conservation area? The officer hasn't applied this test, at least not explicitly. The officer has singled out one element of paragraph 131 of the framework to justify her recommendation to approve, but she hasn't taken account of the policy test laid down in paragraph 138 of the framework to explain why the site fails to contribute to the significance of the conservation area. It's paragraph 134, I think everybody could agree, that is the policy test. Because nobody's arguing that this development would ruin the entire conservation area, but it would cause harm to the significance of, or cause some harm to the significance of the conservation area. That paragraph says, where a development proposal will lead to less than substantial harm to the significance of a designated heritage asset, this harm should be weighed against the public benefits of the proposal, including securing its optimum viable use. Not the private benefits, not how much profit somebody can make from developing the site, but the public benefits of the proposal. The public benefits in this case are the glimpses across the Dee estuary and preservation of the characteristics of the old village, which includes not only the clusters of buildings, but the spaces between them. The officer points out APP 1401341 on Thurston Road was approved in similar circumstances recently. So the committee also needs to take into account the cumulative harm that would be caused to the character and appearance of the conservation area and the setting of buildings of critical importance to it if both applications were to be completed. My clients believe that at the very least the committee's decision should be deferred to allow the officer to apply the proper legal tests, legal and policy tests, and then allow members of the public to respond to her assessment. However, the petitioners submit that the proposal would clearly fail to preserve the character and appearance of the conservation area by eroding the gaps between clusters of development and permanently obscuring glimpses of the estuary which is that's from the public ground, not from private ground, which the conservation area appraisal identifies as key to the character of the conservation area. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. Could you just ask you to turn off the microphone? Thank you. Would the applicants or agent like to make a better representation?
Good evening, councillors. I will be brief in this matter. I think the report from the planning officers is very clear and very thorough in the way in which they set it out. I would just like to add just a couple of things. I should explain, my name is Alison Mackinder. I'm a partner in the practice of Patterson, McCauley and Owens with the architects for this particular scheme. At the outset, we had detailed discussions with the senior planning officer, senior conservation officer, and senior highways officer, all of whom were happy with the proposals we were putting forward. The application that was subsequently withdrawn was for four houses, and we were then requested by the conservation officer to amend this to retain the existing property on the site. As we did, we reduced the number to three houses. As a benefit, we changed the access to that particular property off the access to these three houses, so that it didn't come off West Road with the small road that's, I think it's actually highlighted in the conservation plan. As far as the characteristics of the properties are concerned, this has all been through with your planning department. They've agreed to the materials which we've used on this. They've agreed to the density of the development. So it's very difficult for me to add anything to what the planners themselves have come up with in their report on this particular project.
Thank you.
Thank
you very much. Can I just ask Matthew to comment on Martin's comments regarding the officer's report, please?
Thank you, through you, Chair. The purpose of the committee report is not to detail word for word planning policies contained in the National Planning Policy Framework or the DDP. It's to summarise the salient points so that members are aware of those when considering the issues. The report is very clear in that it does take account of the conservation area and the impact of this development on the conservation area as a heritage asset. It also takes account of policy CH14, which is specifically related to the lower Heswall village conservation area. And policy CH1, which is development of ethnic conservation areas, are clearly identified in the report. And following on from that, an assessment of the character appraisal and management plan is in place for Heswall conservation area as well. The National Planning Policy Framework, the salient points of that are identified as well. And as I say, the impact that the development may have on the preservation and the enhancement of the conservation area have been picked up by the case officer. They've been looked at in detail and that's been summarised in the report. So I'm very happy that the report is clear and concise and the report that sets out all the relevant issues.
Is there
one
councillor that would like to speak
on
this? No? Okay, can I just open the committee any comments?
Can I just ask one question, clarification for myself? The object this was first mentioned, 2014 footprint. Now, could you clarify that point?
14
footnote 9 was the point that he was highlighting in relation to the conservation area. Can you just clarify your views and how you see it?
I
Thank you, through you, Chair. This application was subject to a member's site visit on Tuesday. Planning permission is sought for the erection of two new dwellings within the grounds of Orovales, a large detached property set in mature landscape gardens. And just so that members can understand, this is Orovales, this is the existing property, and these are the two new dwellings. This is plot one and this is plot two. The existing planning will be retained as part of these proposals. And although not subject to this current application, the existing property is to be refurbished and repaired as it is currently in some state of disrepair. The site is located within the primary residential area and also within Caldy conservation area. Many of the borough's older established areas, such as Caldy, derive their character from their architecture and extensive, often mature gardens. As such, new development proposals can offer a challenge to the existing character of the area. The immediate area is characterised by a diversity of design and house types. All dwellings are individual in terms of their scale and appearance. Some are modern in appearance with new builds in the wider area, whilst others are more traditional of early 20th century design. The current proposals for the site, as amended, allow for two new dwellings, one to the rear of the site, that's plot two, and one positioned toward the front of the site, which is plot one. Together with Orovales, the existing dwelling, the properties will overlook the central landscape garden area. The new dwellings are linear in nature, featuring a number of linked rooms. The roof ridges and eaves heights have ensured the scale of new buildings are comparable with neighbouring properties. The use of high quality materials and the contemporary take on design features within the area give this part of Caldy Conservation Area an added identity reflective of the 21st century, reflecting what has been set out in terms of past development, but also introducing a small pocket of 21st century into this established conservation area. As such, it is considered that the proposals positively contribute to the setting of the conservation area. A number of trees will need to be removed from part of these proposals. The majority of these trees are, however, in poor condition, with a short-term life expectancy, and offer limited amenity value as they cannot be viewed from outside of the site. It's also worth noting that 15 of the 19 to be removed, and the council has already granted consent under a tree application works, application for trees in the conservation area, and to be removed. The removal of these trees will allow for the better management of the healthy population of trees to be retained on site, and together with the proposed tree protection measures and proposed replacement landscaping in suitable locations, the site's sustainable long-term future will be better secured. The layout of the dwellings and internal room designs maximise privacy and ensures all standard separation distances are met, both in terms of the relationship of new properties with one another and neighbouring properties. The relocated access will improve visibility for drivers entering and leaving the site, and the existing boundary wall and gateposts are to be reused. This is secured by condition 12. Hard and soft landscaping and tree protection measures are also secured by condition, as is the removal of all permitted development rights, ensuring the council retains control over any future extensions, alterations, or additions. The application is recommended for approval. As set out on the latest, there is now a qualified petition objection.
Marty, could you just show us where the in-person request is?
Thank you. Just through you, Chair. The existing access is roughly in this location. The proposed new access will be here. Internal driveways through the site.
We do have a qualifying petition for this application. Would the lead petitioner like to come forward to speak? Is there a board councillor here who would like to speak? Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Geoffrey Watt, West Kirby and Thurston Ward. And thank you to the chair and members for coming out on the site visit on Tuesday. I think it's a most unusual site visit. I'd often spend the morning in a piece of parkland like that. As has been mentioned, there has been a late qualifying petition, but I'm sorry, I bear apologies from the lead petitioner that holidays at this time of year intervened and there's nobody available to speak. If you look at the report on the lower part of page 30, you can see reasons given by the Public Conservation Area Advisory Committee of the Society why they originally objected, worried about pressures on having more trees removed from the site, and despite revisions that have been made to the original plans, their view is that the proposal represents inappropriate overdevelopment of the site, which would have a detrimental impact on both the house itself and its established mature landscape and the street scene in this part of Cordy Road. At the top of the next page, you'll see a diastic to be taken out of variation. As I believe that the development represents an overdevelopment of the site, and with various putting important trees at risk, and also contrary to various policies, including the Cordy Conservation Area and the Cordy Conservation Area Appraisal and Management Plan, as well as parts of the National Planning Policy Framework. If you go over to page 32, there's a discussion of some of those policies. In the next to last paragraph, starting to the end of the third line, policy CH2 says that development located within a conservation area will be permitted where the visual and operational impact of such proposals can be demonstrated to preserve or enhance the distinctive characteristics of the area. Towards the end of that paragraph, it says policy CH11, which is the Coldy policy, looks specifically to Coldy Conservation Area and states that the principal planning objectives for the area will be to retain the character of a low-density, maturely landscaped suburb with substantial houses in large grounds. And then you come to the Coldy Conservation Area Character Appraisal and Management Plan, which has been adopted by the Council for the termination of planning applications in Coldy. And Orovales, the existing house, is identified as a landmark building that is viewed as being critical to this part of Coldy and the pattern of development in the wider area of this part of Coldy Road. And granted, you can determine by the principle set out in the covenants. Now, although you can't take covenants into account, that management plan agreed with the principles of those covenants, which promoted large rectilinear polygonal plot with houses situated approximately in the middle of the plots. Well, thinking about all those, I believe the history of this plot is that actually several Coldy plots were purchased together, four in all, and the original house was built on the left-hand plot, we might say plot one, but it's of such a size and with its raised terrace and driveway, it actually encroached into plot two. Plot four, the one to the extreme right, is occupied by the flat house in your plan there, number 143 Coldy Road, a quite impressive, more modern detached house. So you are now being asked to develop part of plot two and all of plot three, and you're being asked for two houses, and the solution is what I in my eyes are rather unusual, long, narrow houses, one of which is sideways onto the road. They're scarcely deeper than my own more modest detached house on the other side of the hill, so I find that quite striking. The one they refer to as plot one in this context is more forward in the plot. And it is at present hidden from the road by some of the trees which are to be retained. But as the Coldy Society seem to think, they think those trees are at risk of future because they're actually so close to the house. I was quickly struck by going on the site with this. As we came away down the existing drive, which comes across the front of the house proposed for the rear, swings round to the distant gateway of the extreme bottom left-hand, right-hand corner. There's a big open space about more than halfway back and towards the right-hand side, where there are no significant trees, big open space of sky. It would be far better to develop one more substantial house in that position than to put these two rather unnatural, long, narrow houses at extreme size, which I just don't think is any enhancement to the conservation area whatsoever. Now, obviously, you haven't got that proposed before you. You can only rule on this one. And so, with that in mind, I would ask you to refuse this application and give the applicants a chance to come back with something more along the lines I'm suggesting. The immediate grounds are obviously overdevelopment, threat to trees, and the various reasons which have been set out in the report and in my submission at the top of the report. Obviously, HS4, CH11, and the Crawley Conservation Area, appraisal management plan, as well as the National Planning Policy Framework. So, members, please refuse this application and let me think again. Thank you.
Thank you,
Councillor.
Martin, can you just confirm what you think is the
Thank you, Speaking Chair. As I said in my presentation, the majority of the trees that are to be removed as part of this scheme have already been given consent as part of the application for tree roads and conservation area. So the majority of those trees will go anyway. A tree preservation order has been put on trees here, an area order at the bottom of the site, and an individual order for the tree that's considered to have the highest immunity value, which is a Lawson cypress, which I think is possibly this one or this one. It's certainly the centre of the site. For those members who were present at the site visit on Tuesday, they would have seen that tree. So the area order is this one here. So it's those trees that I think Councillor Watt alluded to in terms of screening the site favourably. Protected by a preservation order which is in place, but it's not been confirmed yet, but it's due to introduce in August. But that they are protected by an emergency preservation order at the moment, and then this one here in the middle of the site.
Okay, can I open this up to committee?
Yeah, so thank you. I went on the site visit on Tuesday, and actually I found it really beneficial because I don't think the image on the paper does justice to quite the size the site is. And one of the things that really came through for me was the screening that the site has on in terms of boundary with Caldy Road. So I'm not sure that I agree that it would necessarily impact negatively on the Caldy conservation area, because actually a lot of it is back, far back from the road and well restricted, and I'm pleased to hear that there is a tree preservation order in front of, I think, was the plot that Councillor Watt and others had the greatest concern about, because it was the one that was potentially most visible from the road. So I'm pleased about that. Also, the access to the site too, because at the moment when I walk back off the driveway, it's very narrow and, you know, it's a road where the car can probably go faster than they should do. And so it's good to see that that's been widened as a result of the scheme with greater visibility. So I think actually this is probably a very good scheme. And certainly, you know, it seems that the developers have been sympathetic to some of the needs of the conservation area.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. It was well worth the site visit. I think the Ward Council gave a good view of the size of the plot, and he said it was a nice open parkland area. I made the comment on the day that the field at the back of my house where we put the housing estate was more than the front yard at this point. I've got to be honest, it really is. When you look at the size of the plot, you can't, we can see that the site there, and we actually look at the map that we have, you see the size of the plots on the opposite side of Caldy Road and the house next door. 143, which looked very modern, I've got to say, very modern and very easily noticeable from the highway,
which again goes against the Commons conservation.
Then you made in their objections. There's only one question I want to ask Matthew. I know it's the trees are already preserved, but when they take away the present access to the new one, will there be any more planting of trees in that particular area?
Thank you, through you, Chair. As you will note, there are quite a lot of conditions attached to this application. And one of those conditions requires the provision of hard and soft landscaping scheme to be submitted to the council for further approval. And as part of that process, we work closely with the applicants about what are the most appropriate locations for replacement landscaping and also the most appropriate species to be planted on that site as well.
Yeah, thank you very much, Chair. I again was one of those who went on the site visit and was very impressed with the site and with what was being proposed in many ways. My concern is more related to the fact that we've taken the time and trouble to produce management plans and appraisals for the Caldy area, as we have in many other conservation areas in the borough. And I think we should give very serious note of going against those plans and aspirations, because it makes us all look rather daft if we create these conservation policies and then immediately go against them. That's my major concern, and I know others in the committee will have that concern as well. This is, without any doubt, a unique site. It's just short of 3 acres. It's got one property on it, and it's been there since 1929. So it's unique in the sense that it demonstrates what Caldy, I suppose, is all about. Whether we can all afford to live there or not is not the point. It is a demonstration of trying to create something which should be preserved for the future. My concern, I haven't been on the site visit, I'm almost in two minds. I can see greatly the benefit of what is being proposed. I can also see the genuine concerns of the Conservation Society and others, and some residents who weren't able to speak for or with the petition this evening. So there's two sides to this particular argument, but having given it careful consideration, I can only come and give you my view, because that's what I'm employed to do. I'm not here to do anything other than tell you what I think is right for this particular site. I'm not going to repeat what my ward colleague Jeffrey Watt said, but he did make the point that maybe somebody should go away and come back with something more appropriate for this site than what is currently being proposed. Now, we can't redesign it. All we can do is ask whoever's involved in this to try and come back with something maybe more synthetic and more in keeping with the conservation area plans and appraisals. So what I wanted to do, Chair, if I may be allowed to, is to come up with a reason for refusal, which in no way is trying to take away what the applicant has tried to produce, but to suggest that maybe an alternative plan might be more suitable for the area. So if I can allow anybody else who wants to come in to speak, once they've finished, Chair, I would like to move a refusal.
In fairness for a debate to be made,